But we have before us a scale that has the correct measurements on it, shows where the fence is, where the fence should be. I will put the fence where it should be. The plantings are in, and you know, I'll work that out with the abutters as to whether or not they stay there, or I guess they would have to stay there. I mean, and they're welcome to be there. You know, but as far as the original plan goes, the buffering that was proposed to be done and accepted to be done has been done. And I can't tell you how strong I feel about that. It was clearly marked 10 sections of fence to start at the back corner of the property, parking lot, and that's where it started. And all 10 sections have been installed.
Maureen?
I guess I'd like to just clarify the issue of how long the fence is supposed to be. When the board approved the plan in 1989, there was a length of fence shown upon the plan. The plan was drawn to scale of 1 inch equals 20 feet. I suspect that what happened is, in order to distinguish the line that is supposed to be the fence, there were little X's drawn in the line to show it is a fence and not the line of the parking lot. The length of the fence is determined by the length of the line. If you were to take the fence and say that we're only supposed to be 10 sections, if you scale off each section, I've just done the first three. The first section is 6 feet wide. The second section is 8 feet wide. The third section is 10 feet wide. The board has never required anyone, as far as I'm aware, to put in sections based on the scale on the plan. The idea is you put in the total length and you put in the section to your own liking. If someone wants to put a post in every 2 feet or every 4 feet, that's how it's done.
And how far off is the total overall fence?
I believe the total length of fence is supposed to reach to that back corner of the house. And
which is how far?
I would say, just scaling it off, it looks like it's at least 85 feet.
Mr. Chair?
Judy?
I'd like to comment to this. I, like Maureen, made a living reading these plans day in and day out. I certainly would have read that would be a fence that would not only be of a certain length of 1 inch to 20 feet, but that it would reach a certain place in the ground which would be equal to the back of the house. There's nothing in the legend to indicate even that is a symbol for a fence, and I think the code enforcement officer's interpretation is the one that most people in the profession would make in his defense.
I would certainly support that, and I would say that it's certainly in the code enforcement officer's jurisdiction to review and be the final judge as to what the plan depicted and to what he deemed to be correctly installed or not correctly installed.
Okay. Once again, I'd like to try to get us to bring us to some type of motion.
I have a motion then, just to get the thing going. I move that we postpone the decision-making for the site plan approval until next month to give the applicant time to get the paperwork in order.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Do I have further discussion?
I think we should make it clear so that when he comes back next month, what he should have. I, for one, would offer, I was in the same problem. I have working up toward 11 amendments, which gets to be, I think, really unwieldy. I think it's easier to just come back and do it. Much like Judy's amendment, I would also might prefer that the hours of operation be not 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. but to 10 p.m. with the sign going off at that time. Did you address the wattage in the sign? Or do you want me to just reiterate what I would?
Maureen, did you take notes?
Do you have notes?
Yes. For all of us, just run down what Judy Lardner had initially listed.
To summarize her proposed, I think there were more issues of conditions rather than specific conditions. But you had suggested that if you start with the motion that's before you on page 3 of the memo, to keep motion 1, that the existing trees and landscaping be preserved, to eliminate condition 2, and that's addressed later, to keep condition 3 and 1993 to that date, for condition 4 to address reducing the brightness of the sign, condition 5 to address, specifically regulating the hours that the sign is lit, and also addressing the floodlight in the rear that lights the parking lot, condition 6 to specify a length of stockade fence in addition to what's being shown, or to specify that you would accept what is now being proposed, and also to look at perhaps extending a fence up to 4 feet in length towards the front of the building. Condition 7, to relocate the existing fence so the entire fence is sitting on the applicant's property. Condition 8, to revise all plans so that they depict the intent of the previous conditions and to make sure everything conforms. And condition 9, to restrict that no building permit be issued until the improvements that are shown on the plan are completed and plans are prepared that are up to date and to scale.
I had mentioned limiting hours of operation, but I know Judith would disagree, so but that was a proposal.
But at least to address hours of operation based on the conversation tonight.
I might also add that, that the existing stockade fence, as it encroaches on the land of the southerly adjoiner, be moved to conform with the property line. It may be, as Randy Blake talks with his people, that they would be willing to grant some sort of an easement for an encroachment. And that would be acceptable as well as an alternative. It may just be that that works out for some way.
Yes, I guess I'd like to ask the applicant to, based on the conversation tonight, to
work with the
abutter and see what, if anything, can be suggested in order to meet the buffering concerns of the abutter.
I guess, as the chair, I'm disappointed on one hand that we can't bring this to some type of conclusion tonight. On the other hand, I guess my own experience over the last 3 years is every time we have tried to pass a site plan or almost any article before the board with numerous conditions, it has not been successful. And it hasn't really done either the board justice or the applicant to walk away with a list of 10 or 11 conditions to an approval. I don't sense we're doing our job, and I don't feel real great about that. And I think where it fell apart for me is when I received a whole different plan that was so substantially different from the initial plan, with having just less than a month to really try to correct those issues. We have a motion before us. I'd ask if there's any further discussion. Tom?
The only other item that we may want to consider as part of the motion is that floor plans be submitted and reviewed and approved by the code enforcement officer, which establishes the occupancy and plumbing requirements. I've heard things about showers. I just simply don't know, according to our ordinances and the various national codes or BOCA, things are sometimes very strangely defined in those codes, and it's very difficult to define what the use is. Just to be sure that the and it's as much in the applicant's interest as anyone else that if there may be a requirement for showers, it may be a requirement for bathrooms that may reduce the area. I just recall the very first sketch that he gave to us about the interior portion of the building, showing bathrooms that didn't appear to be handicapped accessible or perhaps didn't meet the number of people that might be using the facility. And I know there's a critical occupancy load that triggers all of that, but I think that's an important part of this whole thing.
Maureen, is it the purview of the board in this application?
Typically, the code enforcement officer does that type of work after when someone is applying for a building permit, but I think we would at least be able to get some information on the whole issue of maximum occupancy. And in addition, if the board will remember, typically any site plan application is submitted with a letter from the Portland Water District, and it was when the applicant appealed to the Water District for this current application that it was discovered that there probably was not sufficient water supply to the building to provide for the showers. So you know, in that sense, it is a question the board can ask.
Can I just say one more thing?
Sure, Judith.
Then I'll stop. I just sort of want to reiterate what Steve said, in as much as I'm a bit disappointed we can't get this thing through tonight. I really am. There are some conditions which are fine, those that are black and white, conditioning them to things like the hours of operation or changing your light bulbs to 75 watts from 100 or whatever they are. But it's the issue that just doesn't seem resolved in my mind that it can be done by conditions of what was formerly an area that we thought would be buffered with a neighbor has now turned into no buffering, and that the plants are on the other side of the, are actually on the neighbor's property, that that has to be resolved, and I think that has to be resolved with the applicant. And that to me is the real burning issue here.
I'd just like to mention, if the motion carries, then the applicant has another month to bring these things to a more finely tuned application. I would ask that revisit pedestrian traffic, giving consideration to the schoolyards. I'm not talking about extensive work, but it's an issue with me is. Trying to be, as a responsible planning board member, if we're encouraging a site plan approval for use by hundreds or dozens of people, and a number of them will be or may be walking from off-site, that's a responsible thing to take a look at the pedestrian circulation. Any other discussion? Seeing none, we'll bring it to a vote. All those in favor of the motion as made and seconded and amended?
I think it was just to postpone it.
That was just a motion. That's right.
That was
to postpone it for a month.
All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, it's unanimous vote. The article will be postponed until the next meeting. Our last order of old business this evening, and I apologize to those applicants who had to sit through a long session here. The board doesn't feel any better about spending that much time without coming to a resolution either. The next order of old business is Stonegate Phase 4, request by Recall Management Company for a preliminary site plan review of a 17-lot subdivision located off of Stonegate Road, preliminary subdivision plan approval. Section 16-2-4A. As I have before, as an officer of Recall Management in Fleet Bank, Maine, I'll have to recuse myself from participating. I'll surrender the chair to Judith Kane.
I have to recuse myself as well. My firm does business for Recall. Okay.
Okay.
For this item on the agenda, I'm going to appoint Judy Lardner as a voting member. And you are Mr. Light. Would you please introduce yourself and explain what we have before us now?
Yes, thank you. Again, my name is Rick Light, and I'm an engineer with Land Use Consultants in Portland. And with me tonight also is Dick Michael from Dufresne Henry Engineers, also of Portland, South Portland. Before we start, I guess I'd like to just maybe give a quick synopsis of where the project is in terms of who the players are and what's going on with the project. As you're well aware, the original applicant is no longer with the project at this point. And then secondly, I think I would like to ask the board at this point what level of detail they'd like to hear from us, and so we can save some time, whether I should go and give a synopsis of the relapse since the last meeting, as I understand the issues to be, or give a quick summary and of things that have changed and open it up for discussion and in the essence of time. First off, as you're probably aware, recall management on behalf of the FDIC now is in the chair controlling the project. The title is actually in Fleet Bank of Maine, and Stonegate Associates, the previous applicant, is really out of the capacity of the applicant at this point. Where we are involved at this point, Land Use Consultants was retained by Recall to work with Dufresne Henry to basically pick up the project and run with it and complete the DEP site location application issues and as well the planning board issues. And so where I'm speaking tonight, there may be some issues that I may not be aware of. I believe we've done our homework the best that we know of to pick up the pieces, but by all means, I would expect, I would hope there'd be some dialogue tonight if there's some issues that we are not aware of that we've missed in trying to get the plans back in front of the board. We would, you know, by all means, like to hear from the board on those issues. So is it make sense for me to go into some detail as to where, what we've done with the plans, or would it be best for the board to express what they, what was the last plan they've seen so that I can get a better understanding as to where I can pick up the pieces?
I, for one, and I'm speaking for myself, I've been involved with this project from the beginning of Stonegate 4, which seems at this point light years ago. It sort of started and stopped, and then it kind of started up again, and then it was postponed a number of times. Could you do a thumb shell synopsis?
Be glad.
2 or 3 minutes, just quickly through some of the points that we addressed before for the benefit of the board and for the benefit of the other people who are watching, and then address the items that you have changed and how you've changed them.
Be glad to. As I understand it, the last time the project was before the board, let me step back one step further. The original project was a loop road, as you all pretty well remember. And back in 1990, as I understand it, with the schedule I have in the agenda, about the time the dead-end road standards were revised to the Ordinance Committee, the project was redesigned in the current layout of the cul-de-sac off of the Phase 1 Stonegate Road. And at that same time as well, the project was resubmitted to the town, I believe, around May, the end of May of 1991, excuse me. And there was an application made at that time, which was still in the hands of Stonegate Associates, with revised plans, et cetera. That submission was, at the time, there were some outstanding items, even with that submission, as I understand it. For instance, the road length, there was a discussion of whether or not it still met, that submission met the new standards and some other minor issues, too. One of the more major issues besides the road length was the issue of this intersection with Stonegate, Greystone Court in this area right here. And since then, I believe that is about when things ended with the board, is my understanding, right around June of 1991. And what we have done is essentially pick up in December of 1991 and have been given authorization from Recall to go ahead and try and get things back on track. In a very quick nutshell, I think Maureen has done a good job of outlining the different issues in her memorandum that the board of what some of the changes were. I'll just try and give you a quick verbal rundown. The project now is 17 lots, and it's a cluster subdivision as it was before. The road right, the road begins off of the existing Stonegate Road and measures 2,000 feet exactly to the cul-de-sac. There's an existing proposed 300-foot T-intersection road with four lots on it on the left right here, called Quartz Knob Road. The issue of the intersection with Greystone Court, which is this road right here, which is existing, as the board is probably well aware, came up, as I mentioned, at the last submission, and we've addressed that issue right there. The lots are all on septic, and with the exception of lot one, which would be a sewer lot. And the septic HHE 200s have been submitted to Mr. McVane for his review, and I'm not sure the status of those, but testing has been completed on all of the 17 lots, in fact, including lot one. And by the way, this is lot 17 over here. The proposal is for underground power as it was previously. The area that is not held in within the individual lots, basically the areas in throughout here, and all the area that fronts upon the bank of Dyer, the Dyer Pond subdivision, and Stonegate phases 1 through 3, is supposed to be a common area dedicated to the town, as was the area behind Stonegate phases 1 through 3. And that would be dedicated as a in fee to the town, with conservation restrictions placed on that. Just what we've done in trying to pick up the pieces is we've met with the Conservation Commission before this meeting several weeks ago, and we've also sat down with Maureen to kind of go over where some of these issues are. We believe we've addressed most of the issues, and I guess when I sat down with Maureen, there were three or four, I guess, larger issues, more prominent issues, which if you'd like, I'd spend a minute just to go through how we've addressed those, rather than spending the time going through all the little. There's some engineering and some technical questions that were raised in the T.Y. Lynn review letter, and I think in the essence of time, I'd like to put some of the minor technical items aside and get to the plan issues.
Could I just ask you, you do have someone at Recall that's taking a good look at these HHE 200s, right?
I think I can guess who that person might be. I personally have not seen the HHE 200s, other than the test pit information which we have in the file. So my understanding is that those are with Mr. McVane for his review at this point. I'm
just going to have to believe that they're perfect.
Yeah, I would hope so.
And all the pages are there.
Absolutely. Number one, again, the road length. The road is, again, 2,000 feet now, which does conform to the new road ordinance. The road is a 24-foot wide paved road with what we call a box section. That is curbing Cape Cod. Bituminous curbing proposed on both sides. That goes for the Quartz Knob Road as well. The intersection down here, which I believe the last meeting of the board, there was an issue of how to address this intersection here. The road had previously, the existing pavement veers off this way to the right, and there's an issue of how to best take care of this. I think the drawings that were previously submitted showed an island. We have deleted the island here in the submission before you now, in lieu of a T intersection. And there are some minor comments that were submitted through the T.Y. Lynn review, which I believe we've addressed most of those at this point. A second issue which I discussed with Maureen that the board was concerned about was the access to lot three. And for the benefit of the board, let me just kind of walk through the lots here. This is lot one, lot two in here. Three is this entire parcel back in through here, sort of a pork shop lot of about 3 acres. Lots 4, 5, 6, 7, et cetera, all the way around, and then 13, 14, 15, 16, and lot 17 over here, which would gain access through the existing Stonegate Road. And getting back to lot 3, there's an issue of driveway access into the lot, which comes in close proximity to the wetlands in that area right there. We've been out to the field to look at that, and what we'd like to do on that issue, I understand there's an issue of trying to get a deeded or a restriction on the plan, is to decide where that driveway should go. And having walked that in the field, although it's not staked exactly, I think we have a pretty good idea where that driveway or where the lot line should be in here. I think what we would like to do is if the board would be agreeable to, is to add some language to the plan that restricts us to it, rather than the 25-foot minimum setback, which is the existing NRPA permit by rule setback for no disturbance to a wetland, and make that 30 feet on that particular lot. And at the same time, I think we would keep the driveway and put, would put language on the plan which would allow, keep the driveway 10 feet off of the lot line from lot two. There has been some discussion of making a greater setback or putting an easement through here, and I would, being out in the field, I would hesitate to do that for the reason that, and we've, and I just, our survey crews were just out doing the same sort of thing, is when you're in the field to restrict the driveway location to a very tight window, and all of a sudden if you're out there and you come into a beautiful 24-inch oak that you'd like to go around and move it 5 feet, if you have a restriction on that driveway that's so tight that you can't move it 5 feet, then I think, you know, you lose sight of the issue that rather than trying to protect the wetlands, you're knocking down trees that you don't have to. So I think that we would like some flexibility on where this driveway could go, but by all means, we are in agreement as to keeping it as far as practical away from that wetland. The other major issue, as I understand it before the board, one of the other major issues is that of building windows and deciding where they should be and what the restrictions should be on the lots. And in the packet that was submitted to the board, the plan, I think similar to this one, with shaded building windows was given to the board for your review. And I guess it's difficult for me to stand here and address each lot on a lot-by-lot basis, but what I'd like to do is indicate that essentially there is, talking with Maureen, there are several lots that have lesser setbacks to wetlands than others. And let me, I guess, start with by saying that the red line on the plan here is the edge of wetlands, following in through here, et cetera. And essentially you have two knolls, as the board is probably well aware of, dry land up in here, in this area all up in here. There's actually a series of smaller knolls. We have tried in all cases to start with a 100-foot setback on every lot from the wetland to what we would establish as a building window. And what we found is that several lots simply aren't buildable or are very, very restricted with a 100-foot setback. So our philosophy, and after talking to Maureen and understanding what the board's concerns are, is to step back and then try and establish as great a window as we can in all the lots, but at the same time allow a certain amount of flexibility for the builder on those lots, because some of the lots are pretty rugged and I think not too atypical of a cape-type project where you've got ledgy knolls and whatnot. And we ended up with several lots that in some spots, such as lot one, we have a proposing only a 25-foot buffer from the edge of wetlands to the proposed building window. Again, not for the entire lot, but only in a certain location, as you see right here. This is 25 feet, and much of the rest of the lot is 100 feet. There are several lots in through here, lots four and five, where we would propose a 50-foot setback. When you look at this window, you may ask, why can't we increase that to 100 feet? And in these particular lots right here, the reason for this lot is this is where the good testing is for the septic system. So the window needs to be extended into this area here rather than keeping the building window 100 feet back from the wetland. And the same with the lot number six here as well. This lot here, lot number seven, I believe it's seven. I'm sorry, I've got the lots for four and five, and this is six right here. Lot six, we've suggested a 60-foot setback, more or less, to the building window here. Just given the topography of the lot, it just allows for better sighting of the building. And these lots up and around here all have 100-foot setbacks, with the exception of the, we've reduced it to 50 feet in here to allow more usability of the lot within the area here. To bring this up to 100 feet would basically allow two separate and distinct building windows, which really isn't practical. Getting around to lots 13, 14, 15, and 16, lot 13, we show right now a 25-foot buffer from the edge of wetland right here for the building window, almost all the way across the back of the lot. And we've taken a good hard look at that site in the field, and I would like to allow as much flexibility, understanding that we need to protect the wetland, allow as much flexibility, but I think that in reality that the place you would want to site a house would not be back at the edge of the wetlands or 25 feet away. I think it would be more towards the front of the lot given the topography. And these lots here, again, are all 100-foot setbacks. So there are really only several lots, one, two, lot three, we have a 70-foot setback here. Four, five, and six, just in these areas right in here, just only over a portion of the lot. And this 150-foot setback in the back of this lot here that are not 100 feet. And again, for the reasons I've just given, and I would like to hear some of the board's comments in a minute about these setbacks, if they have any concerns about particular lots. Again, one of the issues that was brought before us was that of trails. And what we've done in between the time of the submission and the meeting, we've taken the time to put together, I think for our benefit as well as the board's, so we can understand what's going on, more or less a composite map at a lesser scale, a 1 inch equals 200 feet, of the Stonegate Phase 4 subdivision in here. This is Mitchell Road. This is Shore Road over here. The Dyer Pond existing subdivision in here, and the Stonegate Road that's existing right now, phases 1 through 3, so that we could better understand what's going on with the trails out in the field and put those onto the face of the earth. And we've met with the Conservation Commission, and I've talked with Jack Roberts on several occasions about what the concerns of the Conservation Commission are. And what we propose with the Phase 4, let me just back up and discuss the existing, the red line with a single dash are existing trails or easements or whatnot that are in place, either, again, on the face of the earth or proposed to the, through covenants with the existing subdivisions, which allows a network from Fort Williams over here all the way through to Stonegate and back along pavement, eventually to Mitchell Road. What a connection through Stonegate Phase 4 would allow is a connection from Dyer Pond, which has this existing network of trails, which ties into the Stonegate Phases 1 through 3, a connection which goes to the back of the property and exits out at this point right here, and I'll show you on the larger scale map where that is, and as well the...
Could you excuse me? I've the bottom quarter, left quarter, is completely missing from me.
I'm sorry.
If you could just move it, actually move the, whatever that thing's called, easel over.
To my left or right?
Toward that way.
Say when?
That's great. Oh, okay. Now you're a little more.
If it helped the board, I brought copies of this plan. Didn't want to give them to the board during the discussion.
Did
everybody else
say
no?
Just move the podium and we'll be all set.
Excuse me.
Nope. Well, there.
That's
okay.
Fine.
Nope. More. Okay. More. Nope. I'm back in the same.
How's that?
That's
How
good.
About you, Judy?
Are we all set? Yeah, I have copies of the plan. If I could give them to the meeting or if the board would like, I could hand these out right now. Whatever is the board's wish.
My preference is that you keep them, but if everybody else would like them right now, I'm just going to.
Okay.
I'd rather see what you do.
Distract us. Unfocused from the issues here. The trail system which we proposed is this dashed line through the subdivision, and with a connection along the Dyer Pond extension, which the paper street which is proposed, which I'll discuss in a minute. And discussing with the Conservation Commission, they have a desire to connect from Stonegate Phases 1 through 3 through the back of this parcel, which at this point I am led to believe is in the title of Fleet Bank of Maine, therefore we would have be able to deed that to the town, and then back into the Dyer Pond network right here. And again, all we're proposing at this point is to discuss the Phase 4, but we presented this plan, again, for our own convenience so we can understand what's going on and for the board so they can have a plan that shows all the four of the subdivisions together. Flip you back to the previous plan. Where the trails end up going on this plan here is we propose that they come through the, this is the back of the Dyer Pond subdivision. And this plan proposes, and I guess what the board has requested, basically a paper street extension, which would be a right-of-way dedicated to the town and accepted, though not built or constructed, and to tie into the Dyer Pond subdivision through here. We propose to connect from the Dyer Pond subdivision a trail network to here and branch it off behind these lots in the common space, across several fingers of wetland in here, which are passable by foot, but I wouldn't suggest it without some boots on in the wet weather, and along Lot 3 with an easement across the neck of Lot 3 and across its driveway. And although not shown on the plan after discussing with the Conservation Commission, there was a desire to connect the trail across the backside of Lot 3 here, which we have no objection to, and would add that to the plan, should there be no objection to the abutter. And some issues along the lines of the trails, which we've discussed with the Conservation Commission, is how to cross the wetland here from a permitting standpoint. That's a pretty aggressive stream there, and it would come under the definition of a perennial stream, and therefore is an NRPA jurisdiction. and we have proposed in our discussions with the Conservation Commission a week ago, that I would take a look at that in the field and try and propose it with some sort of a minor crossing that didn't get us involved into a heavy permit process with the NRPA. So we're looking at what we can do to cross this at this point as part of our package for the board. I believe I've touched on most of the issues, and I think I'd rather use this time to get some feedback from the board as to the issues I've discussed or some that we've missed along the way.
Okay. We have someone from the board? Anyone?
I called the town planner earlier today just to get straightened out on the issue of right, title, and interest. And I think the conclusion I've come to is that you have right and title, and I don't understand where the interest will lie in the future. I would believe that if approval is granted, that we then have an approved subdivision that would take with it all the same rights that the previous applicant would have also enjoyed. But at that point, this project will either be offered for sale or put up for auction. Could you just elaborate on that a little bit?
And my understanding with talking with Recall is that that's exactly at this point, that they're looking to complete the project, get the permits in hand from the state level, the federal level, which we do have our permit for the core crossings, and the planning board level. And at that point, I think they're, I haven't been given a firm commitment as to whether they plan on selling the project off or acting as a developer at that point. We haven't really sat down at the table and talked about that, so I can't answer directly, but given Recall's the way they've been proceeding on most of the rest of the projects, it's a matter of trying to sell the project off as a package, not as individual lots.
And for the record, if that were to happen, then the new owner would still have to come back to the town with evidence of ability to perform and provide the appropriate bonds?
Can you answer that, Maureen?
That's my understanding in speaking with the town attorney, that if a project is sold to a new developer, that the board still has authority to review the financial and technical capability of the new developer.
Okay.
You would also have to have transfer of developer rights from the DEP, or it would have to be transferred.
We are in the process of taking care of the transfer of rights at this point from the previous applicant, Stonegate Associates, to Recall, and then again, if a new applicant or if a new owner came into the picture, they would have to, again, have a transfer of title. Unfortunately, there's no way to miss that middle step and still get a permit issued to somebody. You have to have an entity to issue it to from the DEP.
And just so there's no misunderstanding, Land Use Consultant is acting as an agent for Recall, taking it through the approval process, and Dufresne Henry is the engineer of record on the project?
Correct.
Okay.
By the way, Dick, I'm sorry, Dick Michael here, as I mentioned, is here for any technical questions that I can't answer. Dick is obviously very familiar with the project, mm-hmm. and I'm sure you've seen his face over the last several years here, and in a much better position to answer the technical questions that concerning the plans and whatnot.
I probably should have a lot more questions, but we've been through the property. I think the real issues will come up as, or those issues that may not seem obvious now may become obvious as the property, if it is developed and as homes are sited on the property. It is such a variable piece of land, and each home siting is terribly important in the scale of the homes, but we really don't have a lot of control over the scale other than what zoning affords. So I'll get really to the two other issues that I recall being discussed, and that was the development of Lot 3 and in the location of that drive, and there was some concern about the unique nature of that lot and potential impacts on abutting properties as to where that house might be located. And I believe there was a steep face. When we originally walked the site, there was actually an alignment indicated for the driveway, if I'm not mistaken. And there was there was a dead-end road there. Well, that was there's nothing here that I see that's inconsistent with that. The concern I have, and I'll deal with this from a planning standpoint, I don't know that you've violated any of our codes, and that's on Lot 17. Lot 17 appears purely for the enhancement of the profitability of the project, not that that's not a vital motive in this economic time, but I don't see that it contributes anything to Lot 49 or to the lot that's marked now formerly Thielen. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really is stuck back in there, and furthermore, what it does is, if I'm reading the trail plan correctly, It forces everyone now that's this pedestrian way, I understand, is going to, or easement will come along that mutual property line?
There's an easement that exists right now, correct, the trail. The 30-foot easement along the back of this stone gate phases here and connecting on adjacent lot 49.
So in using that trail, the public will be sandwiched between two rear lot lines?
That's correct. A side lot line and rear lot line.
I would just express my concern for that type of development approach, and I that's all I can do. I don't know that you're doing anything that's not in compliance with the ordinances, and I'm not about to withhold approval of the project because of that. It would seem to me to be a real opportunity to provide a recreational open space amenity for all of the Stonegate subdivisions. And it's something that we've noted in our comprehensive plan. Although there's a lot of recreation facility, there's a lot of open space here, there's not a lot of local recreational facilities within any subdivision within Cape Elizabeth. Now, this issue of setback from the wetlands, Maureen, I know that's becoming a real issue with the revised ordinances. My concern here is I think that there's usually room for flexibility, but I don't want to get into a situation where we're more flexible than we are consistent, and that we then have existing homeowners in town coming before the board saying, wait a minute, I mean, you're preventing me from developing on my property to a certain extent, and yet here's a brand new development in town, and you're allowing all kinds of variations in the setback. What would you just, for the board, and I guess if there's anyone in the audience that's listening or interested, discuss what the minimum setback is and what variations we're allowed to take in that.
This project is a good example of a pending application, which is living on after the adoption of new and improved ordinances. This subdivision comes in under the old, before May 1990, wetlands regulations, which means there are no setbacks from the wetland edge. The only setbacks that apply are the setbacks that would apply for any subdivision, namely front yard, rear yard, side yard, land use type setbacks. This application specifically is coming forward for, one, a wetlands alteration permit, and two, a permit for construction in a resource protection zone. So any area where it's coming near a wetland or in a wetland, it's considered to be a wetlands alteration permit. But unlike our current ordinance, there is no setback from the wetland for this project. To provide some address for the applicant, we have talked about building envelopes at length, and the attempt here was that the consultants agreed that there were reasonable locations where houses would be placed on lots, and the attempt was made to draw building envelopes that would ensure that reasonable decisions would be made on where those houses would be located. In most cases, the applicant has tried very hard to maintain a 100-foot setback. There are some lots where it's physically difficult to maintain a 100-foot setback, and that's an opportunity the board may have in looking closely at those building envelopes to make sure that they are reasonably drawn and minimize wetland impacts as much as possible. But to summarize, there are no setbacks for this particular subdivision.
Are there any setbacks that are required at the state level?
I think the applicant has talked about the NRPA permit process, where there's a minimum 25-foot setback requirement. If you go within that 25-foot setback, there are extensive permitting requirements that have to be met. If you're outside of that setback, it's a permit by rule.
Permit by rule allows you anything outside between the 25 and 100 foot.
Right, and if you're beyond 100 feet, then you're beyond any state regulation as well.
Regardless of slope adjacent to that wetland.
Yeah, maybe I could just expound on that. There's regulatory wise, the wetland is jurisdictional within the state because it's a 10-acre wetland. And number two, it's a stream-associated wetland, so that, by definition, a floodplain-type wetland also brings it within jurisdiction. The 25-foot setback line, as everyone refers to it in the NRPA, as Maureen said, is used to be that this 25 feet plus two times the slope, which I think the board members, some may be familiar with, is now been relinquished in lieu of a 25-foot straight-across-the-board setback except if the slopes adjacent to are continuous and greater than 20%, and in which case it becomes 100 foot. And the problem is they were having too much difficulty trying to enforce the 25 plus 2 times the slope. Mm-hmm. And what, between the 25 and 100 feet, what that draws you into is simply NRPA, the state jurisdiction. You're allowed to do a lot of things between 25 and 100 feet, and it just draws you into the permit by rule, which is a very short, quick application process. As long as you meet a set of standards, you are basically allowed to go ahead and put notification to the state. If you exceed, as Maureen mentioned, that if you come within the 25 feet of a wetland or do anything below the normal high water mark of a wetland, other than certain maintenance type activities, you have to go with a full-blown NRPA permit.
Well, where you don't meet the 100-foot setback, would it then become the responsibility of the homeowner, the prospective property owner, then to get the permit by rule of the NF?
Yes, yes. And we have a note on the plan, which I think we may, in my mind, would like to add even a little more detail to that note, but we'd like to make the potential owners very clear on that issue. And if the board has any specific concerns with regards to how to word language for the recording plat, we... All ears.
Okay, those are my major comments.
Judy Lardner.
This wasn't a question I was going to ask, but it kind of follows from what Tom was asking. I understand why this subdivision is under the pre-May 90 condition or regulations, but Maureen, perhaps you can answer this. If we have the building envelopes on the plan, and someone, once this is approved, someone can come in, I assume, and do any type of house building, shed building, lawn creation, and so forth, as long as it's in that envelope. Whereas, well, let me finish it, and then you can correct me. Whereas someone in Brentwood, even though they were also clearly developed in pre-90 regulations or lack thereof, they fall under new regulations when they try to put a shed or a new lawn area? Is that the situation?
Yeah, there's a couple of answers in that. The first one is that in the previous subdivision approved by the board, even if you are within the building envelope, there were restrictions on what you could do. For example, there was language that specifically said you were not allowed to clear cut the lot, even inside the building envelope. So that's something the board may want to think about, not just drawing in the envelope, but specifying what's allowed outside the envelope, what's allowed inside the envelope. Secondly, under our new wetlands regulations, there is a provision in there that exempts subdivisions that were approved with some type of wetlands approval. This would be a particular subdivision. The previous Stonegate would be a subdivision. The intention was that if you had a subdivision lot that had received some kind of wetlands review, that you would be allowed to construct on that lot until the year 2000. So there was an exemption put in the ordinance for subdivision lots that receive some kind of review. The situation with the Brentwood subdivision is that was a subdivision approved prior to any wetlands regulations by the town. It received no review whatsoever, and therefore it falls under the existing wetlands regulations.
So to follow through, they may have more onerous restrictions, even though, again, there are lots of record, and in that case have houses on them. Conceivably, they'd have more restrictions on their lots.
Exactly.
Okay. I have other questions and comments. I don't know if you'd like me to hold them.
Are you
I'm all done.
Why don't you go ahead, Judy?
Okay. kind of skipping around the board here. First off, in response to a very general comment by the town engineer, I'd like to see a list of all the waiver requests that are needed. It's not clear to me what they are. This is something when you go to revise plans, it's a personal thing. I have a lot of difficulty reading the plans, going from the, I think it's the heavier 10-foot contour lines and the edge of wetlands RP zone, and also I find the 25 and 100-foot setbacks rather faint. Whether you want to use, like this recording plat that you've shadowed, I don't know, but it'd be nice to be able to look at it and definitively know that I'm looking at an edge of wetland and not a contour line. There's a lot of crossing, and the lines seem to have the same weight. some of these are more detailed than others. I assume that on the proposed right-of-way to the Dyer Pond Road extension, we will see some sort of proposed deed to the town. Mm-hmm. And with respect to road names, certainly like the applicant to consider if this is what the memo is getting at, whether Greystone Court might have another name. It looks like there would be no current property owners affected by change of name. Is that correct?
I believe not. I believe that three out of those four lots are under the ownership of Fleet Bank. I believe one is...
There's one now formerly Knowlton, but they would have access.
On the corner. On the corner.
Off of Greystone Road.
But there are no houses built.
Okay. Let's see. I certainly would like to see as much sensitivity as possible on some of these lots that, looking at just quickly, like 13 and 4 and 1, and I'm not naming them all, that do have the real constrictions. I can't offer specific guidelines right now, but try to be as sensitive. I would definitely favor not perhaps an exact placement of the driveway on the plans, but perhaps like a continuation of the building envelope to show where you're envisioning, so see if we feel comfortable. I'd also like to know that a homeowner cannot, well, even though he would have the right, I'd like to have him guided in the placement. I know you folks would be responsible, but I wouldn't trust all builders or homeowners. Let's see. I guess just a couple comments on the plans are left then. On the easements that you have running from the public area, kind of bisecting lot 3, and then one running from Greystone Road in the vicinity of Fort Snob Road between 1 and 2, were those thinking that easements would be negotiated with the owners, for instance, in Cranbrook to continue through there, or is that a courtesy to those property owners?
The first question, this easement here, let's see the plan. I believe your plan, again, shows an easement across lot 3 here, and it basically ends at the adjoining property here. As I indicated, after discussing with the Conservation Commission, we intend to take this again over to Cranbrook and provide another 25-foot easement. We left it with the Conservation Commission that we would be happy and willing to do that, but that they should secure. I see no reason to put a trail on a plan that's going to dead end somewhere. It doesn't make any sense to me. And that they would look into connecting through a Cranbrook. I think it's something we want to work in concert with the Conservation Commission to answer that question. And the same issue here. This is the existing Allen Road, which is a paper street. Oh, and there is an existing, probably 12-foot wide dirt road there that's passable to some extent. And it just made sense, I believe, from the fully involved to make an extension through here. And we've discussed with Maureen the legal implications of extending a trail again to a piece of property which at this point is a paper street. The town would have to take over the Conservation Commission or somebody, logistics of making sure that they have legal right, et cetera, to use that street for a trail. But that is the intent, is to connect it through. It makes absolute sense as you walk out in the field. But there are some legal issues that need to be resolved as to ownership of that piece and whether it reverts back to the out-of-town ownership. As Maureen's indicated, at a certain time, a street not used as a public way after X number of years will revert back to mm-hmm. the property owners on either side, and that creates a problem. So there would have to be some follow-up on the extension of those trails.
On the setback on the westerly part of Lot 3, the 100-foot, is that some sort of agreement that the applicant came to with the Gatchos?
I believe so. We discussed that again with not being involved at the beginning of the process, but with the Conservation Commission. And everyone seemed to think that was, no one had any written record, but that was the consensus that the Gatchos had requested that. And when you look at the site, it just makes sense because there's no, this is not the place you would site the house in the first place, so it just makes practical sense.
Okay, then I guess I have one more comment and then one request to the board. Again, minor, on this paper road, I'm very sensitive because I live on a paper road. Mm-hmm. The comment about no construction on Dyer Pond Road, I'd love to see something like it this time. I want lots 6 and 7 to be very aware that a road may go in there. I know you tend to feel very possessive about those areas and you treat them as your own yards.
I agree.
And the other comment I would have is, since two of us here and another member who is not here never heard the public hearing, since we're almost 2 years away from the last public hearing, since there is currently some construction activity going on in the Courier's lot, I would urge a new public hearing on this. And that's the end of my comments, I think, for now.
Okay. Jack Roberts from the Conservation Commission has been waving his hands madly here in the first row, so would you please approach the podium and give us your comments?
Thank you, Judy. The Conservation Commission last September approached the Town Council, and we had a greenbelt policy adopted. I don't think you folks were ever made aware of that. The developer is aware of it. What we have done, and I'll give a copy of that to you tonight. I can highlight what it's all about if you'd like. You just take a second.
So. Why don't you do that quickly?
Okay. In fact, I'll just read it. It's just a page and a half. The Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission has recently adopted a signage system for identifying and marking all trails and significant open spaces within its green belt. The objectives of the signage system are to increase the town residents' awareness of the green belt, thereby encouraging greater enjoyment and use by the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. 2, to develop a consistent, cost-effective system for marking and identifying all current and future trails and open space within with the green belt. To identify trails as a means to ensure that the public remains within the green belt and protect adjacent private lands from non-authorized use. Then the components of the Greenbelt signage system are going to be as follows. We will have trail markers that will be constructed of, we had 11-gauge aluminum, but it's going to be a little less than that, with a standard identifying logo as inconspicuously along trails at intervals of, we had 100 to 150 feet, but again, that depends upon the trail. If this one's clearly marked by usage, you may not need more than every 200 or even 500 feet, depending upon the trail, and the density of vegetation, condition of trail, and level of use. We're going to have the markers mounted on wood bollards, which can be used for trail markers, but the primary goal is to use the bollards at trail heads and specific locations where trails cross roadways. These bollards will be constructed from 6x6 press-treated lumber, or its equal, and we've reduced that to 4x4 as a cost consideration. On a standard marker plate, the post will be directly buried into the ground, with approximately 3 feet visible, and we've decided that should probably be 4 feet with snow and weeds, etc., above grade. One post will typically suffice to identify the trail. However, two or more posts could be used as a chain. We use with a chain or other barrier to prevent vehicular access if needed. We're going to be having informational signs, a couple in town. One would be at Fort Williams, another at Crescent Beach or Great Pond like that, but they wouldn't be at individual developments. It shall be the policy of the town through the Conservation Commission to require all developers or future donors to provide appropriate trail markers and bollards along any trails or easements proposed to be donated to the Greenbelt. A plan should be submitted for review, which indicates locations, types, spacing, installation schedule, concurrent with site plan review. It will be the responsibility of the Conservation Commission to mark trails held by the town at the time of the adoption of this policy. The commission will prioritize and set out markers as allowed by budget constraints. Help may be sought from town departments as deemed appropriate, and availability of town employees and equipment to be determined by the department head. The placement of signs authorizing this policy shall be done in close cooperation with abutting property owners. Pass that along to Judy. You can have that one. And I'm sure Maureen would be more than willing to duplicate that for you. To address one of the questions you had of Rick on the trails that are dead-ending, we specified to Rick that we'd like to have that land, have the trails laid out there, with the hope that eventually we would have access to Mitchell Road or through Cranbrook. However, we are not asking that they be marked. We only want trails marked that have a definite starting point and terminus so that people won't be crossing private property. And Rick has indicated that they would be willing to do that. So we are basically asking to have that piece of land set aside for a future possibility. Anybody have any questions?
I have a question. You've already talked with, you've discussed this with the applicant?
Yes.
And you are planning to have this trail marked, the trails marked?
Yes.
In accordance with this new, so this will be probably the first?
We had hoped ourselves to get into one of these stone gate areas that we have the trails already and do this. However, back this fall, when we weren't knowing what was happening with our budget, with the state monies, whatever, we were unable to do it. So Rick and his group will probably be the first ones that will beat us.
Oh, that'll be nice.
I got a figure today on the markers, and they're going to cost approximately $2.50 a piece, and we'll sell those at cost, so they'll all be uniform.
Very good.
$2.50 a piece.
A bargain.
Such a deal, right?
Right. I'll have... any other questions?
Yeah. How is a trail prepared? In other words, whose responsibility is it? I'm not familiar enough where the trails proposed on this property. In most cases, there are many existing pedestrian paths in the subdivisions I've seen that are not part of the trail system. They generally end up in the house lots, and then there are other trails proposed around the perimeter or in the wetlands.
A number of the trails we have through town are just that they're not marked. At some point in time, we hope to be able to maybe clear those enough so that people could use them and mark them. The particular trails that we have in Stonegate are well-used trails, and I believe even the ones that we're proposing, they're existing.
Okay.
You can't
miss
them.
So there's nothing on the plans that should indicate that the applicant is going to clear or prepare the trails?
The only things that Rick had indicated he might be willing to do is to help us out on some of the areas where crossing might be difficult.
Yeah. Okay.
And getting the permitting and stuff, and making that... some type of crossing for us. Am I correct on that?
Yeah, and that one's on Cranbrook, so
okay.
We can take a look at that. We can look at that in the field and figure out the best way.
Mm-hmm.
Very easy way to take care of that.
There was an area across the street from Mitchell where the planning board had specified in one area there that the developer actually put in a wooden bridge. The development that never came to pass, so that hasn't happened, but it's not... this wouldn't be a precedent as far as asking for some kind of a crossing over an area like that.
Okay. Well,
thank you much, and thank you, Rick.
Mr. Parkhurst?
Just two questions. One's for Maureen. The right-of-way to Dyer Pond subdivision, is it the town's intention to hold that with the intention of maybe in the future paving that?
The idea is that right-of-way connects up to the extension of Dyer Pond right-of-way on the other end. So, yes, there would be an opportunity for the town at some point in the future to actually develop that road. It is probably a good point to mention that I think that right-of-way will probably probably a much higher likelihood that it will be used as a pedestrian point. And then it would be important to make sure that in whatever right-of-way deed that the town received, that it included rights for pedestrian access, not just vehicular access.
Okay, is there any way we can prevent that from ever becoming a public roadway just and keep it a pedestrian easement?
Well, if the land were donated to the town as a pedestrian trail and it wasn't 50 feet wide, then that would be one way to... make it much more difficult for the town ever to develop a road there.
I get the definite sense from when we went on a sidewalk, et cetera, that I don't think anyone wishes to have these roads connect, especially the residents of Stonegate and Dyer Pond. I would, for one, like to see that make sure that we cannot turn that into a town road.
Can I just comment on that issue there? There's several issues I'd like to comment on, but that's something that sits, I have the same concerns with that. My first look at the plans, the first thing that I looked at was the extension of the road, and being involved with this process as much as we are, I fully understand why planning boards require, if not request, actually require within an ordinance, a grudge strip or an extension of the road for future purposes. But along those same lines, that if we at the same time want to make sure that we put all the requirements in place that never be developed as a roadway, then I think we have to ask ourselves, why did we put that there in the first place? So I think there's a larger issue than what can we do within it, and the larger issue is why is it there, and should it not be there, or should it be there? And I don't have the answers to that. I assume that that's been well thought out before this plan got to this point.
I, for one, always wondered why it looked like a road, was curved like a road, acted like a road, but wasn't going to be a road. It just seemed exactly what you said. Why wasn't it just We have curved, you know, the curves as it comes into Greystone Road. It just seemed strange.
I think the obvious answer is I have to assume that along the planning process.
Somewhere in the back.
It was meant to be, should the town's population change 20 years from now, there may be a need to have a road extension through there from safety purposes and just looking at good planning, trying to interconnect roadways. And that makes absolute sense. But I think we have to stand back and ask ourselves the question, what do we want to do with this in the meantime? And if we place restrictions on this piece of land now that precludes the use of it being a road in the future, then, you know, we have to ask ourselves the basic question, why is it there? Or if not, as Maureen mentioned, maybe we can create language that allows that to be used as a pedestrian access. However, this town still reserves the right to create that as a road and use it as motorized access. So I don't think the language could ever be written such that we could preclude motorized access. But I'm not an attorney, but I sort of see the writing on the wall on that issue.
Through the chair. Just to answer the question of how it got there, there's been a long history of the town and planning boards requiring access points or projections of roads. And in addition, if you look at the general standards of subdivision design, section 16.3.1, subsection A, the last line in that first section states that the board may require provision for the projection of streets or for access to adjoining property, whether subdivided or not. It's been a very strong tradition in the town to do that, and it has been done on other subdivisions for, I think, 40 years now.
Thank you very much.
Okay, one last question. Is it in the planning board's power to suggest strongly that Lot 17 be dropped from the plan? I, for one, agree that it seems unfair to park that lot in three other people's backyards. And it doesn't seem to really accomplish anything except for making one more saleable lot.
I think we can strongly suggest that that might be something you'd spend a lot of time looking at.
If I could just comment, I know that question was raised earlier, and I've looked at that issue as well. I've been out to the field and looked at the site and looked at the buildings around it. And that situation actually is not much different from, and I don't know the lot numbers, from the situation you have here, I believe I'm pointing to the right spot, on Stonegate phases 1, 2, and 3. The buildings, I believe it's lot, I guess it's lot 36 and 37, where you have a pork chop lot, as we call it. And you basically have a large house here. I guess they're all large houses, and one behind it. The houses are sited very eloquently, and there's some beautiful landscaping around the homes to separate the two homes. But essentially, you do have a house behind the other. And this is, looking at the topography, in fact, it's very similar in the lay of the land to, this lot here, to what's going on there, with the exception that this lot is about 1.5 times as large as these lots. So I guess if you drive through the subdivision and take a look at around the back of the horseshoe loop here, you get a sense as to what that could potentially look like. And I've looked at that knoll there, and I can understand the board's concerns, but at the same time, it could actually be a very very marketable lot if developed in the right way. And I think that we're, at the same time, receptive to putting restrictions on setbacks. We've tried to maintain a 100-foot setback around the entire building window for the most part. And along those are on that issue, to change the subject a little bit, but along the same tone, is that the building window shown on the plan before you is 100 feet completely around the lot. Looking at that lot, we would like to request that it actually be reduced to 50 feet in here. Not so much that we would intend to putting a building here, but it does allow a little more flexibility in getting a driveway in and whatnot because of the slopes. So I believe if we come before the board again, we would like to make a revision to that and actually make this 50 as opposed to 100 feet right in through here. And when you walk out in the field, I think you get a sense as to why, you know, why that would becomes apparent to try and site a house on that lot.
Well, through, I had a couple of items. Number one, there's been some concern and interest on the board that there be another public hearing. It's been 2 years since the last one, and for no other reason than the fact that this just has lain dormant never mind, I'm not going to get into verbs now, but for so long that it might be a good opportunity to do it, but I would have to have the applicant's approval. I'm not sure that it's something that we can necessarily force you to have right now.
My gut feeling is to say, no, I don't have any problems with that at this point. I take it you need an answer tonight to...
We would just be able to schedule it sooner for you.
Why would we need the applicant's permission to have a public hearing?
Marie? You may not need the applicant's permission, but without consulting the town attorney, I'm not sure that I can give you an answer that, yes, you can have another public hearing.
Does it have to do with funding?
No, it's the way the ordinance is set up for major subdivisions. There's a two-step process, preliminary approval and final plan approval. The way the ordinance states is once an applicant comes in and makes an application, the clock starts ticking. They have 4 months to get their application determined to be complete. 30 days after the application is determined to be complete by the planning board, the board holds a public hearing. 30 days after the public hearing, the board has to make a decision on the application. If the board chooses not to make a decision but to table it, that has to be done with the consent of the applicant. So you've gone past all of those deadlines and you're into the tabling with the consent of the applicant stage. If the board is concerned with holding another public hearing, I would like to point out that even after you make a preliminary plan approval, you can still require the plan to be changed, and as part of the final plan approval, you are allowed to hold another public hearing without getting any permission from the applicant. I'm unclear as to whether you can hold a second public hearing now. I suspect you can, if only because there have been substantial changes to the application.
Can I comment then on that? Not all of it will apply. I would strongly urge you to get the applicant's permission and agreement to do that, because I, for one, would never have voted for a single extension if I thought we were throwing rights like that away, because I think the whole extension business, I understand the reasons for this, I think it is ludicrous. It's taking 2 years to get to preliminary subdivision approval, and I would never vote for another one again if I find that we don't have the power to have. We had a public hearing almost 2 years ago with one person who testified, and I would urge our attorney to find some way for us to do that also.
I'm not saying we can't.
It seems to me as though we're not making much of an issue of the fact that we have a new applicant before us. I can recall a few years back when the person standing behind the microphone had a lot to do with the board's not any character, but the issue is how long is this developer going to be in town and all of these things. We all understand the unique situations because of what's happened in the last couple of years. But on the other hand, I would think that the board should be afforded the opportunity for a public hearing, if for no other reason than for the public to be able to make comments with a new applicant before the board. I think that would be a fair situation. I'm also reluctant to wait until final approval. I think most people coming before the board think that the preliminary approval is a substantive approval. Legally, that may not be the case, but I think traditionally that has been the case in most communities, unless it's something very onerous or something that comes up in the process. But I would like the feedback prior to final approval, if possible. And while I have the microphone open, I would just ask two other questions. One, how about street lighting? Is there any? Is it CMP, or what is proposed on that?
At this point, I can't give you a clear answer on that. We have contacted CMP, one of the issues that was raised in the T.Y. Lynn review letter was the locations of conduit and whatnot for electrical, cable, television, and telephone service. The plans at this level do not show that, and most plans that come before you probably don't show that level of detail, because those are the people that determine. We submit final plans to the utility companies, and they determine where they want to put such things. At this point, we haven't shown pole locations for lighting, and my understanding is that that's something that really hasn't been addressed, but I think this is the forum to do it now if the board has any concerns about lighting on the street.
And one other question. In terms of clearing of existing trees, is it my understanding that the entire right-of-way will be cleared?
I answer that the ordinance clearly requires that we do that. unfortunately, I would say, on the other hand, in the same breath, that we would like not to do that where possible. And let me explain for the board members that aren't familiar with it, with the ordinance, that particular section. That I've been in the same situation before, the same board discussing the same issue. That as an engineer and a quasi-planner, I think we look to narrow the streets and narrow the road clearing as much as possible in all cases. I think it just makes for a more desirable neighborhood. And this whole traditional village neighborhood concept that is running around now is based on some of those theories. The regulations require we clear 50 feet, but then again, this is one of the cases. It's not too atypical from a Cape subdivision where we have ledgy knolls in amongst the subdivision, and it just makes sense where we can, when we can change the requirements for three-on-one side slopes, et cetera, in ledge when there's absolutely no need for it, that we bring the ledge, and we're in a cut situation, not a fill, that we bring the ledge closer to the road and have a steeper side slope rather than a three-on-one, if you follow me. I think you've been through many subdivisions in town that have that sort of a character, and it creates a much more of an interesting character to the subdivision. So there are places in here that we've, if you look on the plan and profiles, that, which are essentially the design plans of the subdivision, where if you follow the intent of those grading plans, that we hope not to clear 50 feet if we can at all avoid it.
I guess the issue in terms of the, I won't speak for the town engineer, but I guess the issue of the intent of the ordinance is to clear it in order to maintain sight lines. Are you comfortable that you can clear less than 50 feet and maintain the sight distances, considering that it's a 20-25 mile an hour speed limit?
I think we can. We have to go back and look at the plans, but I think we come to sort of some sort of compromise on that, especially where the sight lines are concerned with the inside of curves. We have left-hand curves here. The ledge cut, for instance, on the out, mm-hmm. is on the outside of the road here, which I think we can work with that. And if there are areas that the board would allow us to clear less than 50 feet, I think we could take a look at it and point those areas out and make a note on the plans to that effect.
Let me turn that issue over to the planner. Is that something that can be addressed by the board? Is that a standard that can be waived or somehow dealt with other than clearing 50 feet?
The board in the past has waived various sections of subdivision standards. For example, there was in the previous subdivision a requirement for super elevation of a roadway, and the applicant had asked not to do that because of the character of the neighborhood, and it had been approved as a waiver by the planning board.
Okay.
The applicant may want to, in listing the waivers that are being requested, indicate which waivers have to do with this particular issue of maintaining the character of the neighborhood and adjusting road standards for that reason.
Thank you. I think we'll do that.
Judy Larkin?
Just a quick question on that. I know the new dead-end road standards had certain things we could not waive. As far as you know, the clearing is not one of them we cannot waive.
Let me check that.
Okay.
Would we come to any conclusion about a public hearing?
I see no objection to holding a public hearing. I would simply request that we do it as expeditiously as possible, understanding that we have to, I assume, go to public notice again and notify the abutters, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And if that's upon the applicant, there's some time involved for us to do that and some expense. But
Maureen
will take care of that.
Can it be done by the next meeting or scheduled for the next meeting?
Yes. That's the responsibility of the town to do that. I would be
okay.
doing it.
Then we have no objections at this point.
All right.
To do that.
Then why don't we schedule the public hearing for the next meeting? In view of the time, I'm just going to zip through some of my thoughts. I believe Judy Lardner brought up the, or no, I think it may have been Tom, I'm not sure, the Greystone Court, Greystone Road issue.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of those should be changed. I noticed that the fire chief was here for a while, and I think he would have come up and given you some strong recommendations about public safety and similar names when people are in emergency situations. And because there isn't anyone that would be affected, now would be a good time to do it. And you can come up with an appropriate name. Actually, I spent some time thinking of them, but I'll let you do
we'll
that.
We'll accept your list.
Some of the items that I had come up with, wanted to address have already been, the building envelope should be very precise, and not only where they are, but what you can do and cannot do within them. The Lot 2 wetlands I think that we're, Judy's idea of having the building envelope, so to speak, come by that wetland so, to show where the driveway can be put, giving them a little bit of, am I in the right place?
Lot 2?
No,
along,
3.
Along here?
Lot 3.
Lot 3.
Was good. The Dyer Pond wetland pedestrian crossings, that was always kind of an issue, and it still is with me, is the green belt and how people are going to get around, but I'm going to trust that the Conservation Commission that will have that work that out with you. But it would be nice to see something fairly sort of concrete, at least as much as visualizing it for the crossing of that stream. Let's see. There were a number of items that were listed out in the in Maureen's memo, which I'm presuming are all you've addressed, as well as the town engineer's report, which frankly sometimes goes right over my head. but I will trust that you'll address all those to the satisfaction of our town planner and our town engineer. What else did I have to say? You have the trail map that we're going to be able to have.
I'll leave those with you tonight.
Okay. And I do remember. I'm just going to ask you. I had thought that there was, and I must be wrong. I am wrong. That the pedestrian easement, as it went between lots 1 and 2, goes to land now a form of Virgilio. It does not run along the back of lot 2, does it, to the intersecting the other pedestrian easement?
This area right here? The little small extension right
yeah.
in the corner? Actually, I look at the plan now. There's a monument right here, which it's in the field there. That is the extension of the Allen Road.
Okay.
So the first 50 feet here, we should probably, I guess we can denote that on the plan a little better, but that is the paper street that I referred to.
Okay. I mean, it doesn't run along. Then you're going to have the, it will come down the Dyer Pond extension, and you can either go out the Dyer Pond extension or continue straight down through.
Correct.
To, as it crosses the, lot 3.
And there's an easement, 25-foot easement across the neck of lot
yep.
3 right here.
And over to Gatchell's.
That's correct.
Is
and
that
along
right?
the back
and
of the lot.
You're working something with the Gatchell's or not?
Well, that was one of the discussions we had with Jack, is that the Conservation Commission would, I would have a problem putting that there if the Gatchell's have a problem, and that the Conservation Commission were going to pursue, is that correct, Jack, discussing it with the Gatchell's. But I think it makes absolute sense, given that Cranbrook is right here, and this is already an existing buffer. As
mm-hmm.
Jack mentioned, what the intent of the Conservation Commission is at this point is that we would provide the trail through here. And at this point, there'd be no markers at this point until they secure
mm-hmm.
the rights to connect with Cranbrook. And just to expound on that for a moment, the markers that we talked about, we agreed to put a marker at the public access point here and a marker up at here at the, you know, the access point of the trail in here as well. And if necessary, we'd put a marker at the junction here if it's not evident in the field.
Okay. I think for the most part, I've got one cryptic note about C note for DEP has set limits. I think it's on here.
Note
driveway
four.
Construction limited to requirements of DEP.
Mm-hmm.
And that is on lot 3, I believe.
On lot 3, the referring to the lot 3 driveway.
Okay.
I think what was actually taken off that we want to add back on is the NRPA, the DEP NRPA permit by rule.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we're saying is that driveway, and I think we've agreed to putting some language on the plan. We come back before you again, we'll add another note that restricts the location of that driveway. Like I said, I think we can live with 30 feet, but as a setback from the wetland as opposed to 25
mm-hmm.
feet, and still keeping that note on there. What that puts the applicant or the owner of that lot on notice is that first of all, that they cannot fill the wetlands to access that lot. But we, in the same breath, don't want to, as we discussed, I don't want to show them where to put their driveway, because there may be a sighting on 5 feet one way or the other that, that is best taken care of in the field. But we'd also like to leave room in the note and the language there to allow for field adjustments. If we say we need a 30-foot setback and they go out and survey and find it's just a place where we need to be 29 feet, that we'd like to allow the town engineer or the code enforcement officer to make the judgment in the field to allow that. So that we'd like the language to be flexible enough that there's room for field modification.
Okay, and you are going to show the building envelopes as on the recording plan.
On the recording plan. I'd like to discuss that in a little more depth if we have just a minute or two more, and maybe just quickly surmise what I believe are the comments and get an indication from the board as to what I'd like to have a clear indication when we go into the public hearing as to what the issues are, and I think what you voiced, I believe I've taken it all down. But in the issue of the setbacks, the building windows are shown. What we had indicated to the board in our submission is that we've shown them only shaded and not on the actual recording plat until the board has given us some feedback. I'd like to hear, I mean, if now is the time or maybe if there isn't time, if there are any particular concerns regarding setbacks before we go and put these things on the plans and resubmit them to you in terms of actually just a drafting issue of putting these things on the plans. If the board would rather, we can put them on the plans, open up for discussion at the public hearing, and change them again if there are any particular concerns. But I think it would be beneficial to us to know which particular lots or what particular concerns there might be. Again, as I said, if the board can provide that information now, as I mentioned, there are certain reasons why we have certain setbacks that may not be apparent until you look at it in the field or whatnot. But.
Are these building envelopes done with any respect to what's in the field or just strictly by the wetland setbacks?
Yeah, they are done in a sense with respect to what's in the field. And a good example of that is this lot one right here. If the shading, and I apologize for the colors here, it may not be that easy to see, but lot one is this area right here, which is, I believe, about 2 acres. And the building window, you've got a wetland down here and a high knoll right here. When you walk in the field, the obvious place and the most desirable place to put the home is near the top of the knoll, a little bit in front of it, facing the road. However, just because of the configuration of the wetland here, we have even with this small building window right here, we have a 25-foot setback. And to restrict that to more than 25 feet would put a severe damper on what you can do with that lot by putting a notch in there. Mm-hmm. So it just makes good practical sense. And I would remind that for anyone to do work within 100 feet, they still have to provide erosion controls and sedimentation controls, which is really the issue of protecting the wetlands, is within the jurisdiction 100 feet, the state looks at is, the reason they set these rules up are for twofold. One is for protection of the wetlands should disturbance of soil, et cetera, take place within the setbacks, which, again, they allow a lot of work to go on within the 25 to 100-foot range, given certain standards are met. Number two is to allow for wildlife corridors. And the wildlife report that was submitted by Normando Associates with the original application, I believe 2 years ago, didn't find any reason not to... I think it encouraged adopting large buffers where possible, but it didn't particularly mention any corridors that would be hampered by narrowing it down to 25 feet, etc. But this is a case where if you stand at the top of the knoll, there's actually a lip on the knoll, so that any a natural lip, that any disturbance is actually on the other side of the knoll. So whether it's 25 feet wildlife corridor aside for the purpose of erosion control, whether this buffer is 25 feet or 50 feet, the 25-foot does it because of the natural topography puts everything great, it's
sure.
Going away. So those sort of things were taken into consideration. And we've tried to accommodate as large a buffer as possible, but at the same time, there's certain lots that just become very restrictive if the setbacks are too great. But we're certainly, you know, I think the purpose of being here tonight is to sort of get some feedback from the board as to what some of their concerns might be on some particular lots, and we're certainly willing to take a second look at it.
Just a quick comment on some of these lots. You know, we've asked for sensitivity, and when we look at all these setbacks and see you violating the own setbacks that you've written down, I don't mean that in a negative way. It might be helpful to me if someone would take a planimeter on the smaller lots and give us a sense what size the building envelopes are, because I think I would weigh that with you're seemingly close to wetlands if you're telling me you could only, you know, get 20,000 square feet of area to use for lawns and so forth. That would certainly give me a good idea what how I'd lean.
Be happy to. I've got a few more comments just not to keep you here any longer than we have to. But,
oh, no.
Just in going over some of the earlier comments, and I'm probably going to miss some of the thoughts I had in my mind, but the issue has come up from several of the board members about what, when we do establish these windows, what are the restrictions within the window? And I don't think, my indication is that hasn't been established yet. What exactly are the restrictions going to be? Again, I think that's another issue that we're open for discussion about in terms of whether there's clear cutting is allowed or not allowed, et cetera. And I think one of the things that my understanding is at this point, I correct me if I'm wrong, is that driveways, obviously you have to go outside the buffers and setbacks to put driveways in. And the only reason that this was brought up on Lot 3 is because of the nature of the lot and the wetlands. But driveways, obviously, would be exempt from the buffer and such things like that. So I think there needs to be a discussion. What I envision is submitting to you some language on the plan between now and the public hearing, explain what we would like to see done or allowed within the buffer, so we can discuss that at the public hearing.
I think that would be
a little more definitive information in front of us. Just checking my notes here. With regards to the waiver requests, I see now two waivers we'll be requesting. One is in terms of the 50-foot right-of-way clearing, and number two is the issue raised in the technical review letter about monumenting only one side of the road upon final acceptance of the roadway, as opposed to both sides, which the engineering review has agreed that is acceptable given the type of road we have. Another issue, which I believe is outstanding, and I'd like to ask Maureen maybe look at it between now and the next meeting, is the wetlands permit. I would ask, in terms of our records, I have nothing in our record which indicates that the permit application, the amount of fill reflected in this roadway, which is filling at the wetlands right in this area right here, and a very, very minor filling at these wetlands here. And I figured that those, the wetland filling between those two crossings is about, bear with me, a total of about 6,300 square feet. And if you could check your files to see if the original application was revised to reflect the new road alignment. If not, we'd be happy to submit information.
I believe it was, but I will check.
Okay. And I guess the last thing I'd like to touch base on is in response to the T. Weinland comments. We have no problem addressing their comments. They're mostly minor in nature, but there are several things that I think I want to make sure we have the clear indication from the board. And again, without getting into too much detail, legal descriptions should be provided. Drainage and slope easements are noted on the plans. Legal descriptions should be provided in a format acceptable to the town's attorney. I would suggest or request from the board that we be allowed to do that under final, as a conditional final approval as opposed to preliminary approval. The board has no problem with that.
I don't have a problem. Anyone else? Mm-hmm.
No, I'd just like an indication of where they're located.
Okay. I believe the only other issue that I think is actually an oversight on my part is there was a previous comment on page 3 of the T. Weiland letter, the very last issue regards the traffic impact report, and he suggested in his previous letter that we update that to reflect any accident reports since the report a few years ago, and we will provide that information for the public hearing, for submission for the public hearing. I believe all the other comments are minor in nature, and we'll address those with the engineer.
Okay. Is there any, Judy?
Very minor comment. I'd rather make it tonight than another night. Under note 5 on the recording plat, I believe the second line you should be referring to lots 49 and 51 only, because those are the lots of the previous recorded plat, and not lots 17 and 51 only in that second. line.
We'll check that. 51 is supposed to is meant to be included in there. That was for the purpose of an easement along this side of Lot 51.
Mm-hmm. But I thought it was Lot 49 that was being amended.
Lot 49 would be amended as...
And not Lot 17, because you're trying to create Lot 17 now.
You're correct. I'm sorry. Okay. You're correct. Yep.
Thank you.
Just so the board understands that comment, because I'm glad you brought that up, is that Lot 50, the existing Lot 49 of record, as a record lot, will have to, of course, be modified to allow the access into Lot 17, and a recording plat of that lot for the amended subdivision will be presented at some point. I don't know whether that has to go through the planning board. Since that's an approved law, I believe that simply becomes a record plan, or should that be submitted to the planning board?
I believe this recording plat has a note on it that says that it amends the prior subdivision mm-hmm. approval. And I thought I remember reading that on this plat, but that would be the best way to do it, would be to have a note on this plat so that when you record it, you're amending that prior approval.
Okay.
Rick, on the particular drawing I'm looking at, Lot 49, I don't believe has a reference to its ownership. That's the one that shows the building envelopes.
That is Fleet Bank of Maine. We light it to the plan. I believe that's all we have. I guess I'm thinking in my mind, but one very minor thing, and I swear I won't keep you anymore after this,
right.
Is we've discussed what allowances can be made within the conservation areas, especially, again, the Dyer Pond extension, which we've discussed. It's our intent to follow basically the same sort of a model for the land that's to be deeded to the town as was done for the phase 1 through 3 in terms of restricting use on that land, no motorized vehicles, et cetera, et cetera. With the issue of trails, as Jack discussed, we just left the room, is that there are trails on the site now that may not follow where the trails are supposed to go. And I believe it was Jack that said, it was entirely correct in saying that we follow them where we can, but they just simply don't follow the lines of the subdivision. This trail does not exist now, and it would have to be created. This trail more or less exists now, as I saw it under the snow, and I believe can be easily enough followed. And then it's, again, up to the Conservation Commission, I believe, to mark it or, you know, to ford across the wetland here, which is not too bad. But we would like to restrict cutting and make these very passive trails as opposed to very, not a bark, mulched, heavy-duty, active trail that's going to encourage that sort of use, but a very, very passive trail, as you would expect, in the woods out there. And that we're not expecting the board to ask us to do improvements for the trails in terms of bark mulching or providing a detail in a bed, a 4-foot wide bed, and that sort of thing. But this is a very passive sort of a recreation, and we'd like to keep it that way.
How passive are you talking?
In other words, just clearing trees, rather than, typically on plans, if we were to put an easement, if the trail was to be dedicated in a certain spot, and there's a reason for it to be that way, an easement, say 15 foot wide, would be dedicated across the open space. Mm-hmm. And the problem with that is then you're forced to go out and survey that easement, pinpoint that in the field and create a trail within there. And as with the driveway situation here, you may find that you may want to move that trail 20 feet to the right because it's a beautiful ledge knoll. And that's the whole beauty of creating a trail system, is as I see it. And for someone who spends a lot of time on trails, that we look to meander the trail between the existing trees, and if a tree has to be cut, that, again, is up to the Conservation Commission where they want to put the trails, with the exception of the easement, of course, on Lot 3, and the easement here, you have a dedicated path to put it in 20 feet one way or the other to work. But again, we don't expect to go out in this field and survey and field locate locations for trails and prepare a base 4 feet wide with a dozer and go out there and disrupt the environment.
I guess I don't envision that. Perhaps but I also don't envision, you know, here are the woods and find the trail either. I'd like to see something that was followable. Mm-hmm.
I agree. That's what we'd like to do as well. I think we're looking to work with the Conservation Commission. We dedicate the space, with the exception of the crossing, which will, only because it makes sense now, take a look at that in the field and figure out the best way to cross that from a permitting standpoint, mm-hmm. Without getting too serious structures in there, something that's will support pedestrian foot traffic, but not vehicle traffic, for instance, and that we can get to the NRPA process very simply in the Army Corps of Engineer process, and let the Conservation Commission blaze the trail and make it clear where they'd like it to be, and mark it as necessary. And that, I think, is the intent of, as I understand it, Jack, of the system. Good morning.
This is it. You've got 30 seconds.
Well, what the Conservation Commission, I think, had envisioned would have enough work done by the developer that they could take the markers and mm-hmm. place them along from a, so that you could sight from one to the other without going in there and cutting trees or putting down a chip trail or whatever else that you might envision. But having it marked clear enough with their a surveyor or somebody so that knowing basically, so that when you're walking it or skiing it or whatever, you can, if it's it's quite dense, that the markers may need to go as close as 50 feet apart, mm-hmm. but if it's a clear marked trail or clear identified trail that's already no tree is growing in it, then you make one every 500 feet may be adequate. Does that answer your question?
I guess so. I just am fearful of it. This is an issue with me, is the trail system and open ways and being able to access.
We're still in
these
development
gifts
policy
that we have,
development
so
stage ourselves.
But I just envision, you know, coming up Greystone Road, and to the point where the Dyer Pond Road extension comes in, and seeing between lot 6 and lot 7 two houses and 700 feet of forest, and having not an idea where I might be going, and I'm one of these. I won't go on someone's property. I'm very conscious of that. But
that's where they may need to have them quite close, so it is clear to keep people off from the private property and make sure that they can follow it out to here.
Certainly, as it meanders through the conservation area, that's not as much of an issue. Just that it's findable, not that we have them, but you can't find them, and if you. That's all I'm worried about.
Right. We want the residents in the area primarily to be able to use them. And again, the markers won't, because the wood bollards are going to cost more than the markers are. But and it may be wise for someone to clear out some of the smaller brush when they're marking them mm-hmm. to set the site distance between the markers is a little greater.
Okay. All right.
A few.
Judy?
Yes.
Jack, is there any question in your mind or in your mind, Rick, as to any conflicts between a logical trail system and infringements within private property on the site? On the one hand, Rick is saying, and I understand exactly what he's saying, you don't want to go out and just lay down on a piece of land an arbitrary easement description, but on the other hand, I would not want to see a situation where people aren't able to use the trail system because it has to cross any place where it would have to logically cross private property. I believe there should be some method of describing, if not literally on the face of the earth through an easement description, at least the description of a right across several lots or whatever that takes.
Could I interrupt for just a minute and let our planner speak on that for just a moment?
In terms of if I'm sorry to interrupt, but speaking for the town attorney, where we've been, we've discussed these easements in the past. If you're proposing to give us a trail that's on land that will be donated to the town, I don't see any problem with it. But anywhere where there's a pedestrian easement, where the underlying fee is owned by someone else, the town attorney, I really think, is going to require a meets and bounds description of where that trail is.
I think we intend to give that description of the easement on that with a marker, particularly lot 3, and I mentioned the access by lot 1 and 2, I believe it is, and to show it in the field for obvious reasons, because you're going to be crossing somebody's driveway and within 100 feet of a house. But I think the issue that Tom was talking about and the issue of if we allow the trails to go anywhere, there's nothing saying the Conservation Commission couldn't put a trail 5 feet behind the building window of someone's house, which could potentially, you know, which could be 25 feet from the property line, let's say. Which then that property owner may feel they're infringed upon because all of a sudden they buy a house, next thing you know they've got a highway of people out partying and walking on the trails right behind their kitchen window, and nothing to be able to stop them from doing that. But I think that's the extremist look at things. I think the sense is that I've been out there and I've walked, I think I know where the trail goes. I believe at the meeting with the commission, they know where the intent of the trails are to go, and that we simply work as again, to make this a passive system, but the intent of the trails is as is shown in the plan, which wouldn't be, of course, on the recording plan, but to show them generally where they are in the plan and to keep them away from the buildings and buildings that the lot lines as shown, except within those easements that will be dedicated and will be deeded and should be given.
My concern would be that a trail might be given to us that goes over some real rough terrain, and a natural trail exists 30 feet toward the house and would be the obvious route for somebody to be crossing. And I would hope that when these trails are marked out, that could be taken into consideration also, that the land be actually where the people are going to be walking.
That, you know, was something was we just mentioned was, for instance, on lot 2, where the building envelope actually abuts the pedestrian easement.
Does it? Yes, it does.
It does. It might be a thoughtful, to move the building envelope in such a way that there wouldn't be any mistake someday when they wake up and find people tramping 10 feet from their swimming pool.
We'll take a look at that.
Okay.
See what we can do with that lot.
Is there anything else? Any other comments?
Through the chair, there was one question by Ms. Leidner about the dead-end road standards. The mandatory requirements which cannot be waived by the board include the placement of all utilities underground, the dedication of a 50-foot right-of-way, and a minimum pavement width of 24 feet. So there's no requirement that the right-of-way has to be cleared.
Do I hear any motion? Do I have to? Ms. Lardner?
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the information presented, the request of Recall Management Incorporated for preliminary subdivision approval of a 17-lot subdivision located off of Stonegate Road be tabled with the mutual consent of the applicant and the planning board according to Section 16-3-1 of the subdivision ordinance.
Second.
All those in favor?
Should there be reference of the public hearing in that motion?
Be tabled to the next meeting? I don't know. It needs to.
I think the board's already agreed to hold a public hearing. It doesn't necessarily have to be in a form of a motion to schedule a public hearing.
Okay.
Any discussion beyond that? Was seconded by Mr. Parkhurst. All those in favor? It's unanimous.
Thank you, and good night.
Thank you. I don't believe there's any new business before the board, or am I correct? Am I correct? Any further business? So I hear a motion to adjourn the meeting?
I need the motion first. It's been moved that we adjourn the meeting.
And seconded, all those in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? The vote is 3-1. Ms. Kane, voting in the negative. But we will adjourn anyway. Thank you very much.
She can stay here.